Hello, my name is Anne Schober, and I'm a rendering engineer for Epic Games. And today, I would like to give you a brief overview of what we did over the past year with Unreal Engine 4. So let's get started. First, the forward renderer. We kind of knew that MSAA would help us delivering the quality that we need to ship a kick-ass VR title, which would otherwise be difficult to achieve with temporal AI alone. For example, it's hard to keep your head steady at all the times. But we also had some concerns on how to integrate that forward render in a clean way. And one major thing that we did to keep maintainability down was to abstract all our lighting structures using a single function. And then, for example, the simple deferred pass would just load the light from the constant buffer, whereas the clustered forward pass would just load it from a buffer that has been generated on the GPU. Or the tile deferred renderer would work similar to what the clustered forward would do. Another simplification that we did, we still apply our shadows in a deferred fashion. So we still render the dev prepass. And then we resolve it using closest dev and do all our shadowing operations on it, because you have so many different shadowing techniques that keeping it deferred was easier for us. And so that approach has some problems, because you don't have subsample precision on the shadow maps. That's why we, within the forward pass, we search the neighborhood to find an approximate sample that suits us best and use that for shadowing. But this is still an area of further research, and we are open for suggestions to optimize it further. We also abstracted away our reflection captures, and those are sorted from the smallest to the biggest, and that is why we want to give the artist the most control of how they can place the reflection captures, so that the smaller ones will actually take precedence and override the more coarse ones, the larger ones. We support most of the features of our deferred renderer, like, for example, almost all of the shadowing techniques. We support reflection captures, planar reflections, and even debuffer decals. Although there are some things that we cannot support, for example, materials that read values from the GBuffer because there's simply no GBuffer available, or any kind of post-processing effect that would work on the GBuffer, like SSR, for example. That's why we added planar reflections. The biggest performance gains we got by allowing the artist to configure the shader so that they can select between, is the surface fully rough, supports a simple reflection volume, or supports multiple parallax corrected reflection captures. We also allow our artists to switch between per vertex fog and per pixel fog. And in total, we measured a 22 performance increase for Robo Recall. And another good thing about the new forward renderer is that we automatically also gain better quality in the deferred renderer during our translucent pass, where originally we just sampled the light information from volume, and now we could have full lighting. Let's talk about the new planar reflections. As I mentioned earlier, we needed to find a replacement for SSR. And the new planar reflections are fully scalable, so they support most of the scalability options that we have in the engine, like resolution, level of detail. We can even select that only specific objects render into the planar reflection or not. And that gives the artists a lot of freedom, and they seamlessly integrate with all our other reflection techniques that we have. We also support analytical fog in our planar reflections, where we just, when we render the reflection map, we clip the fog accumulation to the reflection plane, and that you can see here nicely. This kind of little. Another big feature that we did is instant stereo rendering. We had some issues because when you have a VR game and a slow CPU, getting everything rendered onto the screen, and for VR we have to render it twice. So we use instant stereo rendering, where we basically duplicate the mesh for the left and the right eye using an instant straw call. And to get rid of basically the area in the middle where the meshes might cross, we use either SV clip distance or ideally SV viewport index from the vertex shader to remove those parts. And although it was originally a CPU optimization and it gave us exactly that, about 40% better CPU performance, we also gained about 12% GPU performance, probably due to better cache coherency. Our new shadow techniques, and just in case you wondered why these husks are there, like standing a little bit stiff, it just reminds me of when my girlfriend asks me if I had brought the trash out, and I forgot. I tried animating those guys actually, and I didn't. I'm not an animator, so I just put them there. And here you see our new indirect capsule shadows for the husks on the left side, and also our new indirect distance field shadows for rigid meshes like the trash can there. And you see how with those new shadowing or additional shadowing techniques, you see how those movable objects better fit into a scene with baked lighting, whereas on the right, without indirect shadows, you think that they're floating over the ground. And we also implemented cache shadow maps for Fortnite, which gave us a 16x performance increase. Another shadowing technique that we did is our screen space contact shadows. Those were originally developed with hair shading in mind. And they just take the depth buffer and then ray trace it for a short distance and a fixed number of samples in the direction of the light source. And that basically gave us an additional scalability options where otherwise no shadows would be available. And it's especially for hair shading, that would otherwise glow if you run into an area where there are no shadows. Let's go to the little bit more technical part of the talk. Here you can see GCN compute unit. You probably saw that overview, like not for the first time. And you can see the four vector units and the texture units and the scalar units. And the reason why I'm explaining you to that, we did some optimization that I'll talk about on the next slide. And the vector units, when they load their data, they load it usually using the texture units, and that goes through the L1 cache. Whereas the scalar unit loads its data using the constant cache, which is usually shared across three or four CUs. So they take a different path. One thing to mention here is that the scalar units don't support format conversion, like the texture unit does. So you can only load like simple formats, ints and floats, basically. Usually, the scalar processor is used to do computation that is uniform across the entire wavefront. So for example, when you load a value from the constant buffer or compute a value that is based on multiple values in the constant buffer, the scalar unit will do this computation. And it becomes mostly free. So with that information, we went into our distance field ambient occlusion and decided that we want to apply this optimization there to better use the scalar processor. So first, we changed the thread layout so that we, instead of iterating over tile after tile, we iterate over objects first, objects being our distance field representation and their bounding boxes. And that allowed us to use group ID, which is uniform across the entire wave, to load that data. And then the shader compiler will figure out and do the math and the optimization by running most of the shader preamble on the scalar processor. And we also had to change regular buffers to structured buffers because, as I mentioned before, the scalar processor does not support format conversion, as structured buffers do not support format conversion. So as soon as you have those things in your, or as soon as you write your shaders in that kind of style, the compiler will have the option to move operations onto the scalar processor. Another thing we found out is, for example, when you read and write to a single value in LDS memory. For example, I don't know, if you have a ray tracing kernel and you have an if-else, and if you do the bounding box checking and in the else you do the triangle intersection, you would probably have some test like if there are enough triangles available. Then as the shader compiler sees that this is only a single value in LDS memory, he will treat the entire branch as if it would be uniform across the wave. With HDR rendering available on all major platforms, we also had to figure out how to compose our HDR rendering with the UI. And just in case you wondered how I put an HDR screenshot on an LDR projector, I didn't dare to try. So I decided to give some love to the audience instead. And Unreal still renders the UI into an off-screen buffer with an LDR range. And to be able to blend that together with the HDR values, we have to bring the HDR values under the UI at least into the same range. Otherwise, the HDR values would just crush over the UI, and the UI wouldn't be completely invisible. So what we do, we take the parts of the images where there is UI and use a simple Reinhardt tone mapper. And based on the alpha value of our UI, we crush that down to a similar range. And after that, we do the blending between the two. And then we output that to the screen. And finally, let's talk a little bit about our high-level abstraction for pipeline state objects. So with the new low-level APIs becoming more and more popular, we had to somehow decide how to interface the high-level with the low-level backend and how to communicate between the two. And traditionally, Unreal tend to use a more unified interface, whereas certain functions are simply left empty. For example, a resolve operation on DX11. But with PSOs, we decided to restrict ourselves to the least common denominator instead. Therefore, for example, we provide the primitive type as requested by Vulkan. We also decided that it's good to combine the setting and clearing of render targets into a single function as required by Metal and Vulkan. And the clear color usually will be provided at render target creation for that operation. And in case that we don't have a matching clear color available or the code pass that's in cannot decide what the clear color might be, we just clear it manually with draw calls. But the fallback, basically, the manual shader clear, luckily for us, this is not so many places. Most of those happen only in the editor and not in the runtime. And as an added benefit, state leaks and their debugging become much less of an issue because now you can trace the state on your call stack. Instead of if you mutate the command list directly, it would be hard to find out what actually state has been set. Latest. Okay, thank you for listening. If you have any questions later, just grab me and you can.